Our scripture reading today comes from the Old Testament, the second book of Kings, chapter 2, verses 7 through 12, and it tells the story of Elijah and his ascent on a chariot of fire into heaven. 50 men of the company of the prophets also went with Elijah and Elisha and stood at some distance from them as they were both standing by the Jordan River. Then Elijah took his mantle and rolled it up and struck the water, and the water was parted one side to the other until the two crossed on dry ground. When they had crossed, Elijah turned to Elisha and said, "Tell me what I may do for you before I am taken from you." And Elisha said, "Please let me inherit a double share of your spirit." Elijah responded, "You have asked a hard thing. But if you see me as I'm being taken from you, it will be granted to you. If not, it will not." As they continued walking and talking, a chariot of fire and horses of fire separated the two of them. And Elijah ascended in a whirlwind to heaven. Elisha kept watching and crying out, "Father, Father, the chariots of Israel and its horsemen." But when he could no longer see Elijah, he grasped his own clothes and he tore them into pieces. May God add his blessing to the reading of this word. I remember when I was growing up, I often heard the term overachiever. The term itself was a word, term of warning. Overachiever, to do too much in one area, to neglect other areas, to achieve a lot, yes, but at some cost. Well, today we don't hear that word as often, or I certainly do not. In fact, the word has been taken, it has been changed. Instead of overachiever, which implies some criticism, we now hear about superachievers. And there are books and articles about how to be a super achiever in your life. Super achievers, we see them. They're all over. It's amazing what some people can achieve in their lives, how some people do seem to be able to achieve so much more than others in one area or in their entire lives. Well, if we were to look at the Bible, look back on all of the prophets in the Old Testament, all the many prophets, is there one that would be a super achiever? One whose accomplishments outstrip everyone else's? One whose honor was more honored than anyone else? Well, certainly, there is an easy choice for that person. The super achiever among the prophets was certainly Elijah. And it's really no contest. Elijah did so much in his life. And this may come as a surprise to us that Elijah is there because, you know, there is no book of Elijah. We might think, you know, every prophet seems to have his own book. There's Daniel and Jonah and Ezekiel and Isaiah and on, but there's no book of Elijah. Well, Elijah's story, instead of being told in his own book, was told in the books of 1st and 2nd Kings. And if any of us here have not read his story, read what he did during his life, if we were to read it for the first time, it would seem familiar to us. Because Elijah's ministry had a great deal in common with Jesus' ministry. For Elijah wasn't just a prophet talking about God's will and what God wants and communicating with the people for God. Elijah was also a great miracle worker. He performed many of the same kinds of miracles that Jesus did. Elijah raised someone he knew from the dead, just as Jesus did. Elijah multiplied food for the hungry, just as Jesus did. And where Jesus fought and easily defeated a legion of demons, Elijah fought with and easily defeated a legion of false prophets in a contest that he had with them. Because of this, all of this, he was and can be considered the superachiever among all of the prophets. And he was rewarded by God. And that's another important thing to know about Elijah, is he was honored for his achievements in life, for all that he did, because Elijah, as strange as this sounds to us, as amazing, as miraculous, Elijah did not die. That is one way that God honored him above other prophets, is Elijah was taken up to heaven in a chariot of fire. And that's not even all there is to the way he was honored. For years and years later, other prophets would say of him that his work on earth is not done. He is going to come back. That's why he was taken up in the chariot of fire, so that he could come back again and he could tell us when the Messiah is going to come. And according to the New Testament, according to Jesus' own words, that's exactly what happened. John the Baptist was Elijah returned. And he did his job of starting and beginning and heralding the ministry of the Messiah. Yes, he was greatly honored. Elijah was. He was the super achiever, and he achieved this status among all of the other prophets. And these other prophets were great. They were so close to God. They told God's wishes to the people. And yet here is Elijah, who had done so much more and was honored in such a special way, in so many special ways by God. And why was that? If we could say that we were going to write our own book about being super achievers, and we were going to take Elijah as an example, what was it about him that made him a super achiever that we could take into our lives? We could be super achievers when it comes to God. Well, the one thing that set Elijah apart, and this is repeated over and over in his story, was Elijah had a very particular, very special, very strong zeal for God. That is what the Bible calls it, a zeal for God. He had a strong spirit. He had a strong desire to be close to God and to do God's will. It's certainly true. Anyway, desire is an important part of our relationship with God. You know, our relationship, how close we are to God, really comes down to how close do we want to be? How close do we choose to be to God? How much of ourselves are we willing to give to that relationship, our relationship with God? Put it in sports terms. We all, I'm sure, have at one time or another watched some sporting event where the underdog, major underdog, defeats the team that was favored to win, that everybody expected to win. And after the game, when the underdog team is being interviewed in the locker room, inevitably, some reporter will come up to a member of the underdog team and say, "How did you do it? How did you do it? How did you beat this team? They've got better athletes than you. They got better coaching than you. They got so much more going for them than you did. How did you beat them?" And almost inevitably, we'll hear the response, "Well, I guess we just wanted it more than they did." Yeah, we just wanted it more than they did. That's a cliche, but it is so true in so many areas of our life. Our desire matters. What was different about Elijah? What brought him up to that level of super achiever among prophets? He wanted it more. He wanted that closeness with God. He wanted to do God's will. All of this about Elijah, everything I've mentioned up to this point, the fact that he was a great miracle worker, the fact that he was close to God, he had this zeal for God, the fact that he was honored because of that great zeal he had. All of this information tells us something important, not about Elijah, but about Elisha. Elisha, that's who I want to think about today. Elisha and his encounter there with Elijah in the very last part before Elijah ascended up into heaven. Elisha was Elijah's protege, his student, his disciple, perhaps his friend. as well. He is the one who would carry on Elijah's prophetic career in Israel. Elisha would become what Elijah had been. And he was there with him at the very end, right before he was taken up into heaven. They were there at the Jordan River, and Elijah performed his last miracle, great miracle. He got a cloak and swatted the river and it parted before them so that they could cross without getting wet. They walked across the Jordan, and as they did, Elijah asked his protege, Elisha, "What can I do for you? What do you want? What do you need as you go forward? I know what you're in for, so let me know what I can do. Is there any information I haven't given you that you want? Anything I can do for you?" And then Elisha asked this incredible thing of Elijah. He says, "Let me inherit a double portion of your spirit." Wow, what does he ask for? What does he want from this man who was known for his spirit, who was known for his zeal for God, who was known for his great desire to be close to God? What did he ask for? Twice as much spirit. It's kind of like going up to Michael Jordan and telling him that your ambition for your basketball career is to be twice as good as he was. Not just as good, not better than he was. I want to be twice what you ever were. This is a big request. And I have to admit, when I hear this, a part of me cheers and a part of me groans. The part that groans, I groan because this attitude, wanting so much more, it's so common among us as human beings, all of us. Always looking on to the next thing, always wanting more, never being satisfied. Wanting so much more than we have right now instead of being grateful for what's right here in front of us in this moment. Now, no one is guiltier than this than yours truly. I remember one of my fondest memories is a day that my family and I spent in Seattle. We had set aside a whole day to walk around downtown. And we were only about a half a mile from the Space Needle, so we decided to start there. Our hotel was there, and we took off walking. And I remember it was a beautiful walk, just that little short half an hour walk up to the Space Needle, a beautiful neighborhood, a beautiful day, a nice walk. But I remember the whole time I was looking up at the Space Needle as it got closer to me. Oh, what will it be like to be up there on top of the Space Needle? I can't wait till I get up there. And then 30 or 45 minutes later, when we were finally up on top of the Space Needle, I was looking out around Seattle and looking down and saw the monorail. I thought, ooh, the monorail. I wonder what that would be like. How much would that cost four people to ride? Then we could ride downtown, because that takes you right deep downtown. I wonder what that would be like. And then when we were on the monorail, I was thinking, it's about time to get some lunch. You know, there's a good sushi place up here, and we should go try that. I was thinking about the lunch. And then when we were eating sushi, I was thinking about going to Pike's Place Market to see the people at the fish market throw the fish around, which you're supposed to go see when you're in Seattle. And then we were in Pike's Place Market, and when the fish were flying back and forth, I was thinking about having to get my bearings for my walk home. And we walked along Elliott Bay, and as we were walking along that beautiful walk, I was thinking about, it's almost a free happy hour at the hotel. That'll be nice. Oh, that'll be great. And then when I was in the hotel enjoying my free beverage and my hors d'oeuvres and sitting there with my family, I was thinking, oh, it'll be so nice to lie down in bed. Oh, that'll be great. And then when I was lying, finally, I was lying in bed. Surely at that moment, I could enjoy that moment of rest and relaxation after a long day, and I was sitting there thinking, oh, I hope we didn't miss anything today. And going through my head about all the things we could have done that day that we missed out on, we walked right past. Well, this certainly is typical of me, and it's not just my vacation, it's not just one day, this is every day in my life. It is almost every moment in my life. One moment, the most enjoyable moment, thinking about the next thing or worrying about that moment being over with and ending and worrying about it coming to an end instead of enjoying it in that moment. Enjoying that gift that God had given and has given to me. Does this describe you, maybe? In some of the moments of your life, some of the happiest moments of not being able to fully enjoy them because you're worried about the next thing that is coming. I see myself in Elisha. In Elisha's desire there in that moment as he's saying goodbye to his teacher, his mentor, his friend, thinking about the next thing, thinking about the next moment. I see myself there in my own unwillingness to accept the blessing of this moment, right here, right now. You know, it's one of the great things about preaching. It's one of the intoxicating things about preaching, the addictive things about preaching. So I'll tell you, right now, as I preach and whenever I am preaching, I'm not thinking about tomorrow. I'm not thinking about the bills that need to be paid. I'm not wondering about the future. I'm not regretting the past. Now, you may be thinking about tomorrow as you listen and yesterday, but I'm not. I am in this moment right now. I have to be. And it's wonderful. It's why people do all sorts of dangerous things. Jump out of airplanes. Ski off cliffs. It's because in those moments, they can't think about the future. They can't think about the past. They are in that moment. Elisha's request for more, for twice as much as what Elijah had shown me, make me think that he is not in that moment. He is thinking about tomorrow. He's thinking about what he needs, and he's asking for this great gift. And that reminds me of myself, and so I groan a bit as I hear. But his request makes me cheer, too. Elijah, there, known for his great spirit, known for his zeal for the Lord, known for his desire to be close to God and to do God's will. What do you want from him? What will you ask of him, Elisha? And Elisha says, I want twice what you have. Everything you have, all that you've done, I want it doubled. And I cheer because, you know, Elisha is not asking for in that moment to be twice as handsome, to be twice as powerful, to be twice as rich, to be twice as popular. He is asking to be twice as close to God, or to be given the ability, the chance, the opportunity to be twice as close to God, to do God's will better, to feel closer to God. Now in this request, he is recognizing, perhaps even in that sacred moment, this may be a part of every sacred moment, every moment we're truly appreciating, is to the recognition also that we are on a journey. We are, each and every one of us. And we have chosen as our destination a closeness to God. In our lives, to draw closer and closer to God through His Son, Jesus Christ. And how do you do that? How do you grab on to more spirit, to more desire to be close to God? Well, there's only one way to grab for that. There's only one way to get it, and that is to reach for it. And that's what Elisha did. He reached for more. He reached to have a closer relationship with God, to have that opportunity to do God's will. And to do it even better than Elijah before him. And so there he is, asking for that chance to be closer to God. And when I hear him ask, it does make me want to cheer as well. Well, you'll be glad to hear that Elisha did accomplish great things during his ministry. He was also a great miracle worker. He also raised someone from the dead. He also multiplied food. In fact, Elisha performed twice as many miracles as Elijah. Did twice as much, according to the record books. And that's wonderful, and it's good to know that he was blessed in that way. He never, though, did get out of Elijah's shadow. You know, he's always considered Elijah's understudy, not Elijah's assistant, Elijah's shadow. The point was to be closer to God, to feel that in his heart, to grow closer every day, step by step, because he had this spirit, this desire to be close to God. Well, then may we all be able to nurture in our lives the ability to truly appreciate, to truly give thanks for each and every moment as it is given to us. If you want to draw closer to God, that is one step to do it. To appreciate and to give thanks for every blessing, to appreciate each and every moment given to us without worrying about the future, without regretting the past. But even in this contentment, even in this joy that we come from appreciating God's gifts to us, let us also be willing to reach out and to grab for all the spirit, all the desire, all the zeal for God that we can manage to get. Let us bow. Loving God, we do give thanks for all of your many blessings. Thank God for the fact that you do give us a journey on which we can undertake, a journey that leads us closer to you. Lord, help us to stay on that path. Help us to make sure we are always making you, through your Son, Jesus Christ, our destination each day. And if we take steps, help us to make sure they're steps toward you. Loving God, like Elisha, we do ask that you bless us with spirit, with zeal, with a desire to draw closer to you each day. Loving God, help us to see that as we do that, we gain in our ability to appreciate every moment and in our ability to show love to those around us. Loving God, all these things we do ask in Jesus' name. My friends, if you are looking for a church home, I would invite you to come forward now during the singing of our hymn of invitation and join with this church by confessing your faith in Jesus Christ or by transferring your membership. Let us stand now as we